morning that through Jesus we can do anything. We can do all things. It's through him. Our hope, our strength, and our help comes through him. Hallelujah.
Hey, through you I can do anything. Oh, I can do all things, 'cause it's you who gives me strength.
You can move mountains. We believe that you can break strongholds. We believe that through you, God, chains can be broken, lives can be set free, hearts can be mended. Come on, let's declare that. I believe that. I believe, I believe, I believe, I believe in you.
I'm not gonna live,
not gonna live.
on, the Bible says that we will face circumstances that may feel like they'll take us out, but through God, He's won the victory, He's victorious, and He reigns on high. So God, we thank You for Your ultimate sacrifice, God, that by Your stripes we can be healed. By Your nail-pierced hands we could be set free. God, that through Your blood we're washed clean. By His stripes we are healed. By His nail-pierced hands we're free. By His blood we're washed clean. And now we have the victory. The power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame it all. And He is one of freedom. Jesus has won it all. Come on, lift your hands as we sing hallelujah.
The victory.
You have won the victory.
Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You have won it all.
You have won it all for me.
The death could not hold you down.
Can you give the risen King your praise and your worship? God, we are forever thankful for your ultimate sacrifice. God, that your love continuously washes us clean. God, that your power and your might, you sit in the throne room of heaven and you intervene on our behalf. God, there is nothing worth more than your presence. In this house, in our lives, in our country, God, we need your presence now more than ever. If that's your prayer this morning, can you just close your eyes and lift your hands to the Almighty God? Lord, we need your presence. Lord, we need your presence.
There's nothing worth more or that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Oh, in your presence, Lord. And I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Oh, in your presence, Lord. Oh, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the fear. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. In your presence, Lord.
Come on, ask him again. Lord, won't your presence come? Yeah.
Your presence, Lord.
Say
there's nothing worth more
or that could ever come close.
God, nothing compares.
Nothing can compare.
You're our living hope.
The sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone.
Your presence, Lord,
oh Holy Spirit, your presence. Your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware this place.
Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere.
God, we long for your glory.
Your glory, God, is what our hearts long.
Won't you overcome us with your presence?
By your
sing it again.
Presence.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place.
Holy Spirit,
you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence. Oh, Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
God, you are welcome here. Won't you fill our atmosphere? Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Oh, your presence.
Your presence, Lord.
One more time, let's sing from our heart, God. Of your presence, let us experience the glory of your good. Tell him that this morning.
Let us become more aware of your presence.
God, we want to experience
let
your goodness.
Experience
your glory.
Glory of your good.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory. Time, just the voices. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place.
Won't
and
you fill our atmosphere?
Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Can we just lift up our hands and welcome the presence of the Lord here this morning as we begin to sense His peace settling into this place, as His presence invades this room and dwells in our heart this morning. Welcome Him here. Father, we're so thankful, Lord, that you are here with us and in us. We thank you for the peace that brings, that you bring, that surpasses all understanding. We thank you, Lord, that in the midst of every storm and every trial and every test, there is this awareness that you are with us, and that somehow, some way, you're going to make a way. Our confidence and our faith and our hope and our trust is in you. You've never failed us. You've never forsaken us. You've never left us. And today we say thank you. And Lord, we take the next 30 seconds to pour from our heart to let you know how much we love and how much we appreciate and adore you. Would you just take the next 30 seconds and love on God right now? Come on, love on Jesus.
And fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Oh, in your presence, Lord. Oh, we need your presence.
Come on, if you're thankful for his presence this morning, give him praise. Amen. How many of you know that God has set us up today? God has set us up today for a miracle. I really do believe that with all of my heart. And I believe we're going to leave different than when we came this morning. If you believe that, put your hands together one more time and give the Lord praise. Do me a favor, just turn around and just greet someone and let someone know how much you appreciate them being here this morning. How many are sensing what I'm sensing here? How many sense the presence of the Lord here today? Come on, let's give him praise. Amen. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but I'm telling you, God's going to do something awesome in this place this morning. You wait and see. Amen. Just be praying and believing by faith. I want to give you a quick update on our property. As I told you last week, we were meeting last Monday with the developer, the city officials, just a preliminary meeting. So once again, just Jason's going to come, and he's going to just let you know what's going on here. So let's welcome him again to the platform.
Good morning. It's another great day here at Life Point Church. I don't know about you guys, this is my favorite time of year. I just came from the preschool class. I'm on loan for a few minutes, so I got to hurry up and get back there. But hope you guys stick around. I know the preschoolers and the children's church are working hard. special presentation for you on Christmas Eve. So hopefully looking forward to seeing you all there. Also, we have a few new faces in preschool. That's awesome. Praise God. Very exciting. Very exciting. So as Pastor said, we had a very productive meeting last Monday with the city officials of Painesville and the developer. We kind of got some clarity to the path that needs to be followed. So we have to kind of trust the process at this point. So as you're aware, the property in Shamrock Center is a planned development. So anything that happens or anything that goes in there has to be approved by both the city of Painesville and the city of Mentor. As it is now, the developer is in the process of updating his plan. And how many of you know we are in his plan? So he is in the. He needs to submit that updated plan to the Planning Commission of the City of Painesville this week. On January 11th at 7:30 in the evening is the Planning Commission meeting. So if any of you can be praying and hoping and believing, a little bit of extra prayer for the 11th at 7:30. So the step is the Planning Commission will approve, hopefully, approve the revised plan for the development. It then goes to City Council of Painesville, and then goes to City of Mentor for their formal approval. So it's a lot of steps, it's a lot of process, but we are believing and hoping, and really got a good sense Monday, and we're really thankful for the city officials of Painesville taking their time out of their busy schedule and having that pre-planning meeting with us, so we really grateful to them. So again, January 11th, keep it in your thoughts and prayers.
Thank you, Jason. Again, if you have any questions, you know, you can see Jason, not until he's done in the preschool room. Let me just say I appreciate Jason and Amber so much. You know, that's all right. Give them, let them know you appreciate them. And I also thank the Lord that Jason is willing and cheerfully and joyfully, along with Amber, serve our children. You know, not a lot of guys step up to the plate and do that for us. And for them to be able investing in your children, your grandchildren, says a lot, doesn't it? And it means a lot. So, Jason, thank you. Let Amber know we appreciate her too. Amen. Praise God. Our ushers are coming at this time. And let's just be, again, let me just say thank you. You've stepped up to the plate. Some of you, for the very first time, are trusting God in your tithe. Here's the, that's all right. Here's the deal. Just keep believing. Keep watering that seed. Amen. You don't plant a seed and tomorrow it props up. Be patient with God. I'm telling you, God is faithful. Amen. Can I get an amen here? God is faithful. Someone came to me a couple weeks ago and they said, Pastor, I thought I was going to have to ask you for our money back. Remember, I said, I'll give you a 90-day challenge. Start tithing for the next 90 days. And if you don't see a change and a difference, come back. I'll give every dime you gave back to you. And they're just like, I thought we was going to have to come back and ask you for it. And I don't know if it was unjust or not. But anyway, they said, but what happened was that there was some money that the department and whom they worked for had forgotten, belonged to them, okay? And they came back and said, we're so sorry, we've made this mistake. This was due to you all along. This is yours. And it was more than enough to make up what was lacking in their situation. How many of you believe that God, come on, God is faithful? You were given or should have been given a hand or an envelope. On that envelope, there's a special spot. Let me see that, brother. Thank you. Yeah. Christmas outreach. Thank you. I'm having trouble seeing up here. Christmas outreach. Here's what we're going to do. We are adopting a couple of families within Life Point Church, and these are families with children, and we want to be a blessing to them. Obviously, we want to keep that private. We don't want the whole world knowing that, and we want to keep that private on who we are going to be blessing this Christmas. So if you want to be a part of that blessing, please make sure between now all the way through Christmas Eve, you can do that. Mark your envelope, put the extra offering in. That money will go to help that those families to make a better Christmas for them. How many of you know that it truly is more blessed to give than receive? It really is. And so you're going to make some child's heart really, really happy on Christmas morning. And we have some designated shoppers. We found some people that love to shop. Okay? We found some people that love to shop. And so they're going to help us out with that. But you're going to help us out by sowing a seed and blessing these families. And so whatever you can do, it's going to be much appreciated. Amen? All right, I'm going to pray and then our announcements. Father, we thank you once again for your faithfulness. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for this church, Lord. I thank you for the heart of generosity that resides within this local assembly. Lord, we once again lift this property up before you and everyone who's involved in it, everyone who's making decisions about it. I pray that you would give us favor with them. Lord, favor in the eyes of man. More importantly, your favor. Lord, we ask God that you take the gifts that we're sowing into your kingdom, that you would use it for your glory and your honor. We thank you for the privilege and opportunity to bless others in this season. And we'll never cease to give you the praise nor the glory for it. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen. And everyone shouted, amen and amen. Go ahead, ushers.
Good morning, Life Point.
Good morning.
How is everyone on this beautiful, chilly, brisk winter morning? I almost said Christmas morning. It's not Christmas frozen. Morning yet. Are you all frozen? No?
Who's ready for summer already? Anybody out there ready for summer?
Boo. Somebody said boo. Some people do like winter. That's okay. And you know what? It's good because that's why we put you in the parking lot because you like it cold. Anyway, it's so good to see all of you here this morning. Lots of new faces. Welcome to Life Point. We love when we have guests. If you are a first-time guest, please stop out at Life Point Central right when you first come in. We have a little gift for you. We have some people that want to get to know you a little bit, maybe get a little information from you. But welcome to Life Point. This is your first time.
Absolutely. Adam, very happy to help you here.
Who are we talking about today?
We're talking about somebody that you all may know.
Oh, Pastor Parsons.
Pastor Parsons in the house. He is our Feature Friday. We just want everybody to see this face one more time. So Alan has been with us since mid-2015. Super appreciative that you're with us. He is serving very faithfully on our First Impressions team. You may see him out there greeting you in as he comes in. And I'm just going to read you a little bit. This is posted online, but I just want to read what he had said about Life Point. The impact Life Point has had on my life has been life-changing. I've grown in my relationship with Christ here and found a community of people who love and support each other. I love our church, and I'm excited to see what the Lord has up next. The best is yet to come, absolutely. So thank you so much, Alan. We definitely appreciate you.
Where are you at, Alan? Raise your hand. Let's see. Yeah.
So in line with what we were kind of talking about, I look at these every week, and I hope most of you see these online. And there's always a common thread in here, and that is growing in Christ, but also growing in family and in a connection. And that goes back to the church's mission of building one life at a time. And it's very evident in everybody's lives when we see that's happening. So we love hearing these stories, and we absolutely want to continue that as well. So definitely appreciate you.
All right, we're going to talk Christmas for a little bit. 2 weeks from today, we will be in the Fine Arts celebrating Christmas Eve together. I'm excited. Are you guys excited?
Yes.
You know, Christmas Eve is always such an awesome service at Life Point. We have some really neat things. Jason alluded to our children. You guys are going to love what our kids have this year. You know, our praise team always has something outstanding for us. We have some funny stuff that's going to happen. I can't wait for that. But you know, it's our tradition that after the service, we all hang out, we have cookies, and Santa is always there. So if you like to bake, we need cookies. So stop at Life Point Central, sign up. We always have tons of cookies, so that's a good thing because I like cookies. Anybody else like cookies? I like cookies. Okay, well, me and Josh will eat the cookies. But anyway, you know, we've talked about inviting people, and there are ways for you to help us invite people. Adam, remind us again what we talked
about
last week.
Absolutely. So in addition to a very large sum, what is it, 20,000?
Yes, 20,000
invites that we've
postcards.
Sent out to the surrounding communities, we have some extra. So again, we'd love to have you invite people that you may know, your friends, your family, anybody that you want to see in church sitting next to you Christmas Eve. So we have a couple ways to do that. They can fill out some information at Life Point Central.
Yes, or go online, lpcmentor.com.
lpcmentor.com, there's a way to fill out the form, and we will send that specifically to that person. So just give us the name. Give us the address, and we'll have that in the mail for them as well.
Yeah, so, you know, it's not a day that we just want to keep to ourselves.
What's going on back there?
Sorry, something going on. Looks like we may have a guest. I don't know.
Right?
Maybe this
Are
guy.
Good?
Hold on.
How about you, little guy? Getting ready for Christmas?
This guy thinks it's Christmas Eve already.
Excuse me.
Oh,
Who's that?
Who is that? Oh my goodness. Is it Jimmy B?
It's Jimmy B.
It's the famous Jimmy B.
Everybody give it up for Jimmy B in the house today.
Praise God.
What are you doing?
What are you wearing?
Are we interrupting something?
Why, no. No, I'm just inviting people to the most wonderful time of the year, and that's Christmas Eve. Oh. It's our celebration at Life Point Church. Everyone's invited. Praise God.
Love that.
All
Amen.
Right. Well,
why don't you come on
come
up?
Come on up here so everybody can check you out.
You want me up here?
Come on. Let's hear it for him as
Thank
he comes
you,
to the stage. Woo, Jimmy
Praise
B.
God.
We got to get that suit in the spotlight immediately.
Man.
Jesus.
So,
how's everybody doing?
What we were talking about inviting people to church. Is that what you were doing?
Day and night.
How do you do that? Some
we
of
are
us
family.
May not be as good as you are. So explain. What's that in your hand?
These are salesman cards. Amen. And I asked the Lord, I said, since we're ad-libbing this, praise God.
Oh,
now, you know how
gosh.
You see in the movie.
I'm sorry, I just saw your shoes.
You guys all, oh, you love that.
You've He's got his elf shoes on today, too.
Praise God. Like. The Lord said, bring your best. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not just a reader of the word. I'm a doer.
Okay.
At Life Point Church, we do the word.
Okay.
Amen.
How does that card help you?
Now, I looked at the card, and I always refer back to my boss. Lord, what is it about the card? And I could not think of anything. And then all of a sudden, the Lord kept making me look at this drink. And he said, taste and see. That Life Point Church through Jesus Christ is good.
Amen.
Amen. That it's good.
So what are you doing with these cards?
We're passing them all out to our loved ones in the hopes that they're going to take them. They're going to pass them to their loved ones and their loved ones. And I just want to know right now, who is family at Life Point Church here?
Anybody
Raise
have
your
family?
Hand.
Anybody family?
Raise your hand.
A
Who is family? You know what I mean by family. I am family with Life Point Church. Amen?
Yes.
I will be at the special Christmas Eve celebration. Amen? Because if you know Pastor Ken's heart like I do, he's all about you. As he drinks from the Lord, you drink from Pastor. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And so it's going to be a wonderful time. Has he ever done us wrong with these certain occasions and special events? I love it. I love it. He has a heart for the Lord, and I love it that he speaks through Christ. So, what I'd like to say right now, and all glory goes to God, is this. This is the way that the Lord brought Life Point Church to my heart. And he said it in a parable. And I love, praise God. You know what? Thank you, brother.
Okay.
Look, we're all family. I'll be brief. But he brought it to me this way. He brought it that there was a master riding in a limousine, and he was a breeder of fine dogs. He was a breeder, and he only wanted the choice ones. So as he's driving by with his chauffeur, James, praise God, we'll get to him in a minute. Praise the Lord. Okay, I'm going. He said, he went past an alley and he saw a stray dog. And he says, stop, James, I want to get that dog. And he went over there and he brought that dog over. And James looked at him and says, Master, that's just a mutt. He says, but I'll take care of him. I'll groom him and I'll treat him right and I'll love him. He says, he'll leave. He won't stay. And so they went on and he took the dog in and he groomed him and he loved him and he treated him right. And James still said, nah, he's a mutt. He's not a purebred. He's a mutt. The master said, patience, James. One day they wake up. The dog's gone. James went, ha! I told you he was going to go. One day went by. The master was just wondering where he went. Another day went by. Then all of a sudden, another day goes by, and they hear a little tap on the door. James opens the door, and here it is, the mutt who brought a whole bunch of other mutts because he knew where it was good. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God on three. One, two, three.
Praise God. Okay, so if you want to join the Christmas Master James here and invite people to church, raise your hand. We've got some cards that we want to put in your hands right now. And, you know, take these cards and do like Praise God Balzano does and pass these out. We have 1,000 of these cards, so we expect that Fine Arts Center to be packed, okay? So keep your hands up. Our ushers are bringing their cards. Thank you so much for being our guest today. Let's hear it one more time for
we James love you. Belzon. Thank you, Jesus.
All glory
all right,
to God.
Pastor
all right, everybody, have a great service.
All right, let's give it up for Jimmy B and the crew right here. Amen. Amen. It's always a dangerous thing when you give Jimmy B the mic. But we love and appreciate him so much. Listen, I was just listening to a podcast yesterday, and they were talking about how Christmas is the new Easter, meaning that more people are focusing and paying attention at this time of the year about Jesus, our Lord and Savior. And it's an awesome opportunity for you to take time. You know, people are open more at this time of the year to receive Jesus. And so just take some time. You may be saying, you know what, I'm kind of shy and backwards. I have a hard time. Listen to me. God has given you boldness through His Holy Spirit. Hello? He's given you boldness through His Holy Spirit. Think about that person whom you're inviting. Think about the impact that God will make on their life, the difference their life will be with Jesus. And just be bold enough to just hand them a card and say, you know what, I'd like to invite you to Life Point Church December 24th, Christmas Eve. And then let God do the work. Amen? Do your part. God will definitely do His. You believe that this morning? Okay. I believe you believe. All right. How many are ready to continue to unwrap Christmas? Yeah? Let's continue to unwrap Christmas. We're going to have communion in a few moments, okay? And I just believe God's going to do something powerful in our lives this morning. I really have felt that all week. You know, you feel certain things throughout the week when you prepare and you're praying and seeking God. And I have just really felt all week that God is going to bring healing in some lives today. Emotional, physical, spiritual. It's in this room today in the name of Jesus. And I really do believe God's going to minister healing today. So let's all just kind of focus for the next 32 minutes and let's believe God for some miracles. How many of you know this is the season of miracles? This is the season of supernatural things. It really is. So let's read. Let's read the account together here. Let's look at it. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. These are the facts concerning the birth of Jesus Christ. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. But while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant by the Holy Spirit. You understand that, right, guys? Okay. Then Joseph, her fiancé, being a man of stern principle, decided to break the engagement, but do it quietly, as he did not want to publicly disgrace her. And as he lay awake considering this, he fell into a dream, and he saw an angel standing beside him. "Joseph, son of David," the angel said, "do not hesitate to take Mary as your wife. For the child within her has been conceived by the Holy Spirit. And she will have a son, and you shall name him Jesus," meaning Savior. "For he will save his people from their sins." This will fulfill God's message through his prophets. "Listen, the virgin shall conceive a child and shall give birth to a son. And you shall call his name Emmanuel," meaning God is with us. When Joseph awoke, he did as the angel commanded and brought Mary home to be his wife. But she remained a virgin until her son was born. And Joseph named him Jesus. Father, once again, we thank you for your gift, your son, the Savior of the whole world, our Savior. We thank you and we give you all the praise. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. One more time, put your hands together and just give the Lord praise. Emmanuel, God with us. Isaiah, the silver-tongued prophet, prophesied this very thing 700 years before it came to pass, Isaiah 7:14. Matthew testifies of the same event in the past tense. And they both speak of a virgin and the arrival of God in the flesh. In other words, God literally stepped out of eternity and God stepped into time. God wrapped himself in a flesh and blood suit and confined himself to the limitations of humanity and dwelt among us. Knowing this, knowing that in our sinful condition, in our sinful state that we inherited from our father Adam, knowing that in our sinful state and condition that we could not get to him, he came to us. To me, that reveals a couple of things. It reveals his desire to redeem man, but it also reveals his longing to have relationship with you and I. I don't know if you realize this morning, but God's one desire, think about that for a moment. God's one desire is to have fellowship with you and I. The God of all creation, the God who has no rival, the God who is superior in all things, longs, craves, desires to have a relationship with you and I. So much to the point that he said, I will come to them so that they can come to me. Aren't you thankful for that this morning? Come on, aren't you thankful for that this morning? And so the Christmas message is the creator of the universe became a human being and was given the name Jesus. But here's what I want you to notice. Matthew was careful to point out that he is Jesus, God with us. God with us. The creator of all. Jehovah is with us. He is God, but yet he also took on the form and also embraced humanity. So he is, as the Bible tells us, he is the God-man who came to us. And the greatest present that ever was given to man was on the very first Christmas when God gave us Jesus. The greatest present you and I will ever, ever receive. Do you realize that the first night that baby Jesus wept was the first time that God ever wept? Do you realize that the first night that baby Jesus went to sleep was the first time that God ever slept? God, the creator of the universe, had to learn how to walk just like all other babies. God, the creator of all things, fell down just like all other small children, learning how to walk and got back up again. God, the creator of all things, scraped his knees just like all the other little boys playing in Jerusalem. He, the teacher of all things, the answer to every question, went back to school. He had to wait to go to Jerusalem for the Passover until he was 12 years old. I'm trying to get us to see that he was just like every other little boy in that aspect. The Bible lets us know that he grew up and learned a trade. That trade was a carpenter. He was a carpenter by trade. Could you imagine Jesus building your table? Could you imagine Jesus making your chairs? Could you imagine taking your chair to Jesus and asking him to repair the leg that fell off? We're talking about the God who spoke this world into existence, now becoming a carpenter. And I think that's just a little bit of an insight on what God is showing and revealing to us about Jesus, letting us know that he is the builder of life. He is the rock of our foundation, that he can build and he can put our lives back together. Amen. It may come disassembled and all kinds of parts scattered here and there and broken pieces everywhere. But as the designer and carpenter, he's able to put it all back together. And such were some of us before we encountered him. Amen. He literally came and lived like we lived. God came down in the form of man and lived just like you and I. I believe it's important that we understand this, because I believe that this reveals to us the real Jesus and not the religious Jesus that some people have made him out to be. I want to say that again. I believe that this reveals to us the real Jesus, rather than the religious Jesus that some have made him out to be. Because him taking on humanity lets us know that we do not serve a God who is distant or distraught. We serve a Jesus who understands everything that we're going through. We serve a Jesus who understands everything that we face. We serve a God that is connected to us by the Spirit, which speaks of his divinity, but we also serve a Jesus that can relate to every situation that speaks to us about his humanity. He understands every temptation. He understands every struggle. He understands every issue that we find ourselves in. He understands every fear that we battle. He has experienced everything that you and I have experienced or will ever experience, but the Bible said he came out sinless and victorious. Amen. Listen to what Hebrews 4:15 tells us. For we do not have a high priest. The high priest represents man to God and God to man. That high priest is Jesus. We do not serve a high priest who is unable to sympathize and understand our weaknesses. Some would say, well, you don't understand what I'm facing. You don't understand my struggle. You don't understand my situation. I may not understand it, but I know one who does. You don't know what I've gone through. You don't know what I've faced in this life. I may not know, but I know one who does. Amen. Listen to what it says. It says, but one who has been tempted, knowing exactly how it feels to be human. In every aspect, as we are, but yet without committing any sin. Do you understand that we serve a Jesus who can relate to us through his humanity, but we also serve a Jesus who can turn around and redeem us through his divinity? What an awesome God we serve, amen? What an awesome God that we serve. Now, I really feel like God laid this on my heart about the real Jesus and the religious Jesus that some people have made him out to be. The religious Jesus that some in the church have made him out to be is a Jesus that cannot be touched. Is a Jesus that hands us a list of rules and regulations. Is a Jesus that only the holy people can come to.
I think that we have been guilty in the church of creating and presenting him the religious Jesus. But God said, I want to come and dwell among man. I want to come and dwell among humanity. I'm going to show them that you can live a victorious life on this earth. I'm not going to short circuit. It wasn't, you know, you have to understand, when Jesus came to this earth, he needed sleep just like you and I need sleep. He needed to eat just like you and I need to eat. The Bible just said that he was tempted in every way that we are tempted, but yet without sin. In other words, Jesus wanted us to know that I am real and I understand and I can relate. But more than that, I can transform your life and I can change your situation and I can change your circumstance and I can cause you to live and be a victorious person through me. And so sometimes I think we turn people away from Jesus because of the facade that we try to portray as Christians. It's going to get tight in here right now. In other words, this facade that we have it all together, that we never, ever have any problems, that we never have a bad day, that we never have a sick day, or we never have any struggles. You know how we do. Hey, pastor, how you doing? Highly favored. Blessed and highly favored. Pastor, how's it going? I'm the head and not the tail. I'm winning in Jesus' name. Come on, somebody. Hey, pastor, how's it going? Well, you won't believe what happened to me this morning. The angels of the Lord woke me up today. And I floated right out of the bed on the cloud that they had prepared for me. And they ushered me right into the bathroom as I began my day. And I woke up quoting Ezekiel 37. I mean, sometimes that's just how people see us, because we put on this facade, when in reality, there are times that I feel like I've been ran over by a semi. Anybody can relate to me this morning? There are times that I feel like the tail and not the head. There are times that I feel like I'm in last and not in first. There are times, like this morning, that I have trouble opening my eyes and finding my way to the bathroom. Don't mean to be too graphic here, but you know, I'm just telling you the truth. This morning I had trouble opening my eyes, so I had to go by memory. Anybody ever done that? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Come on, eyes open up. And you have to feel your way through. How many of you know there are times that you have to faith your way through some things, that you don't have it all together? Newsflash, there are some times when we miss the mark. In case anybody wants to know what that means there are times that we fail and we sin. Come on, somebody. We've not arrived yet. We're getting there, but we're not there yet. I'm going somewhere with this. Sometimes people have this ideal that if you are a real Christian, you always have this sense of joy and peace within your heart. And yes, we do experience great joy. And yes, we do have deep faith. And we know that nothing will ever be able to separate us from the love of God. But we still bear the wounds and the scars of a human life. We bear the wounds and the scars of a human life. And watch this. So did the risen Christ. There is just something about authenticity. There is something about transparency that is far more powerful than a facade or a certain image we're trying to portray. When we started LifePoint Church almost 4 years ago, one of the things that we said was we want to be real. We don't want to be phony. We want people to know that you can be saved and still struggle at the same time. We wanted people to know that we don't have it all together, but we're better than we used to be. We're not where we need to be, but we're better than we used to be. As a matter of fact, one of the first messages that God ever gave me for Life Point Church was the man who was sitting in church with the withered hand. And he sat in church with that withered hand. And one day Jesus showed up to church. And Jesus saw that man sitting in the synagogue with his withered hand. And this is what he told him. He said, I want you to stretch forth that hand. And if that would have been us sitting in church, I know exactly what we would have done. We would have stretched forth our good hand because we don't want anybody to see our bad hand. But yet this man stretched forth his withered hand. And when he stretched forth his withered hand, the Bible said that Jesus didn't heal it, but Jesus restored it. Jesus restored it. And so when we stretch forth whatever withered part we give to God, whether that's our heart, when we stretch that forth, God not only heals it, but God also restores it, amen, and brings it back to its original condition and position in Him. Look at your neighbor and tell him, be real. Just be real. Your scars will attract more people than your style. We have this certain style. We have this facade that we just have to portray, but your scars will attract more people than your style. We may impress people with our strengths, but we connect with people through our weaknesses. That's a good place to give God praise. As a matter of fact, I'm bringing Christmas and Easter together. Is that okay? I'm bringing Christmas and Easter together today. As the Lord kept giving me this message this week, I'm like, Lord, do you know it's Christmas and not Easter? I think He knows, but anyhow. I want you to look at this scripture in John 20. This is after the resurrection. Let me set this up. Jesus walks into an upper room where the disciples were hiding out in fear. Jesus walks into this room and He says, peace be still. And then, listen to what the Bible says. He showed them His hands and His side. And how wonderful was their joy as they saw their Lord. Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Leave that up there, Shannon. He walks in. They see Him. He says, peace. They hear Him. But no response. No response. He then shows them His nail-pierced hands and opens up to them His pierced side. And then look at the reaction that takes place. And how wonderful was their joy as they saw the Lord. Do you realize Jesus was willing to do something that most of us are unwilling to do? And that is He showed them His wounds. He showed them His scars. And this is where we miss it, because we love to show people our victories. We love to show people our success. We love to show people our accomplishments. We love to display our trophies and wear our medals proudly. But we tend to shy away from showing people our scars. That's something that we typically don't do. But here's what I found. I have found this. When someone is distraught, when someone is disappointed, when someone is in the midst of despair, they don't want to hear about your success stories. They want to see and they want to know and they want to hear, has anyone been through the pain that I've been through? Has anyone suffered what I have suffered? Has anyone hurt like I hurt? Has anyone experienced disappointment like I'm experiencing? Has anyone been rejected like I have been rejected? Is anyone frustrated like I am frustrated? Has anyone been abandoned like I have been abandoned? Has anyone lost everything like I have lost everything? I want to know, is there anybody out there that can identify with my pain? I don't. When I'm in that season and time of my life, I don't want to see your trophies. I want to see your scars, and I want to see your wounds, and I want to hear you can make it. You can make it. They need to see our wounds, and they need to see our scars, and they need to know you can come back from this. They need to know you can overcome this. They need to know you can bounce back from this. Someone needs to know in this room this morning, you are going to make it. Someone in this room needs to know you are going to survive this. Someone needs to know that your pain is about to become your greatest victory. Someone in this room needs to know that God is with you in the midst of the middle or the temptation or the trial that you find yourself in right now. God is going to see you through it. He's going to do it. Come on. The wounded Christ is Lord and Savior of our wounded society. The wounded Christ is Lord and Savior of our wounded society, and our society is wounded. Do you realize that there is scar tissue all over this place this morning? And even though we are in church, sometimes we act like we float above life's dirt. But we're not fooling anyone. Hello? And besides all of that, if there aren't any visible wounds in the Christian community, no one will want to be a part of it. Do you realize what happens in this room every Sunday? Do you realize what happens in our life groups throughout our semesters? Do you realize what happens when we just gather together? Do you realize what's going on? Do you understand that we are coming together as broken people? We're coming together as wounded people, but we're coming together as people who have been forgiven, and we're coming together as people who know how to praise Jesus in spite of their pain and in spite of their loss, and in spite of their difficulty. Yes, you can be a Christian and still struggle, and yes, you can be a Christian and have pain, but yes, you can be a Christian and live a victorious life as well. Jesus modeled that for us. And it's the wounded praising people that attract people. You believe that this morning? Listen, if I were to give people an opportunity to come up here and grab this microphone and share their testimony, one of the common themes, the thread that continues to run through LifePoint Church is this, and I've heard story after story after story, and I even have my own, story after story of people telling me, I was hurt, I was disappointed, I was wounded, I left church, but I didn't leave God. All of these things, and I'm like, God, what are you doing? You're putting together a group of people who are wounded. You're putting together a group of people that have bruises. You're putting together a group of people that have scars, and you're building a spiritual house to let this community and to let this world know that you can overcome whatever you face in this life. If you really knew the pain of that person sitting next to you, if you really knew what they've gone through in their life, you would know that you're sitting right beside a miracle right now. Come on, let's give God praise for miracles all over this house. And that's why the disciples were so glad to see Jesus with those gaping holes in his hand and side. The Bible said his wounds caused them great joy. Once they saw the scars of Jesus, that's when the transformation occurred. And they began to rejoice. How ironic that seeing scars, which are produced by pain, provided joy and hope. Scars produced by pain provide joy and hope. It's here in this passage, when Jesus shows his wounds, the disciples, and then Thomas a week later, recognize him as the risen Savior. Why is that significant? Why was it to them and why is it to us? What if Jesus would have appeared to his disciples without scars? Could they have been able to trust that this was the man that truly was the risen Lord? The one who died on the cross? What if there were no trace of scars on him? Would they have then also questioned his humanity as well as him being fully divine? Would it make us question Christ to truly identify with him as our Lord and Savior? I'm so glad that Jesus showed his wounds and his scars, because they bring us hope and they are significant to our faith. I want you to hear this, and I know it's Christmas, but listen to me. The scars of Good Friday are visible on Easter Sunday. And those scars are merely reminders of how you have overcome, how you have persevered, and how you have made it. Amen? How many of you believe that this morning? We're going to prepare to receive communion, and this is what I need you to do. If possible, unless you have to go to work, I don't want anybody moving all around, because this is a moment where we are going into the operating room and God's going to operate on some hearts. So I want you to be considerate of that this morning. Be respectful of people this morning. But I want you to stand to your feet with me right now. Ushers, if you'll come. They're going to hand the sacraments. Please, do not partake until I lead you through. Just wait on me. Go ahead. Prepare, but just wait on me to lead you through. I want you to just start preparing your heart as we begin to minister in song right now.
Could be so small, how tiny fingers reaching in the night were the very hands that measure the sky. King. You're here with us. Still a mystery to me. How his infant eyes have seen the dawn of time. How his ears have heard an angel symphony. But still Mary had to rock her Savior to sleep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Heaven's love reaching down to save the world. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Son of God, servant King, here with us. You're here with us. You're here with us. Jesus the Christ, born in Bethlehem, a baby born to save the souls of men. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Heaven's love reaching down to save the world.
God comes to us and he says, I know your pain. I know your hurt. I know your disappointment. I know your grief. I know your sorrow. Let me show you my scars. But I want you to know I'm with you. I'm in you. I'm for you. You'll never go through anything alone. I'm Emmanuel, God with us. If you'll take the wafer and pull it from the first pack, let me walk you through this. There's two packs. You'll pull it off, and then there's, if anyone's having trouble, just raise your hand. Someone will help you. I want you to get the wafer out. I want you to just put it in one of your hands. And in a moment, I'm going to lead you through something. Sometimes as you're preparing, but let me just say this. Sometimes I wish we were able to have just a piece of bread and pass it around because it represents his body, which was broken and beaten and battered for each and every one of us. And sometime it would, if we could just take that bread and pass it from the next person, where you literally would have to tear a piece off to receive it. Just the symbol of it, of the ripping and the shredding that his body went through. The scars that his body bore so that you and I could be healed. I felt it all week, church.
God wants to heal your hurt. God wants to heal that pain. Those words that were spoken and bruised your spirit as a child, God wants to heal. Those disappointments, God wants to heal. And sometimes people can say everything out of concern and compassion, but it still doesn't bring the healing that you need. Jesus, as I alluded to, when he walked into that door, said, "Peace." But it didn't bring joy. It wasn't until he showed them that joy entered their heart. And it's not necessarily anything I'm going to say or anything anyone else is going to say. It's just when you come to the realization and revelation of his scars, healing's going to take place in your life. I want everybody to hold that wafer up, and I want you to break it and hear the sound of a broken body for you. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you." Would you partake in the body of Jesus? That's symbolic of his healing for your life. Whatever you need, maybe you're in a relationship that needs healed, receive it this morning. I feel like there's a wayward son that's disconnected himself with the family and you haven't heard from him for a while, and I'm just believing God's going to heal that relationship this morning. Just receive it today. Receive it. The same night he took the cup, symbolic of his precious blood, the blood that washes away all of my sin, past, present, and future, the blood that was shed on Calvary for the remissions of sin for all of humanity, the perfect Lamb of God, the spotless, sinless Jesus, for a moment in eternity and time, took every sin known to man and bore it on his body, in his body, on that cross. He did it for you. He did it for me. Would you partake in the blood of Jesus? The ushers are coming. They'll receive the cups here. I want to pray for some wounded people. I want to pray for some hurting people. I want to pray for some people who know what it is to carry scars. I just want you, if you could, it may be your first time here, maybe your, I don't know, however many times we've been here. But if you are believing this morning for God to heal that hurt, that wound, that scar, I want you to just, by faith, step out right where you are and come. Just come. Just come. Thank you, hon. Come on. Some of the greatest hurt you'll ever experience is church hurt. I know personally. David understood it.
when his son Absalom rebelled against him. He said, this was one we took sweet counsel together. We worshiped together in the house of the Lord, and he's betrayed me. God wants to heal you this morning. Someone's been wounded because of a relationship. God wants to heal you this morning. Someone's been wounded because of abuse in your life. You've carried it. And it's caused shame and grief and guilt in your life, and you've carried that. Jesus paid the price so you wouldn't have to. Would you come? There's still room at the cross. Come on. It's okay. I knew this week God was going to heal hearts, wounds, and hurts. And he wants you to know the whole gist of this message is he knows what you're feeling. I wish you could see what I see right here. God is mending and healing hearts. Come on. We'll make room right down the aisle. Just come on. Scoot in. Scoot in. Those of you that are here praying, just scoot in. Come on, we've got some more people coming. Come on, scoot on over so we can get some more people. Just keep hearing in my spirit, don't carry this any longer. Give it to me. Don't carry this any longer. Give it to me. I'm going to pray. I don't know if I'll actually lay hands on you this morning or not, but here's what I want to have happen. Just like what happened in that room that day when Jesus walked in and they were afraid and they were in fear, I'm just going to ask that God would reveal his wounds but show his healing power to you. Father, I can't do it, but you've already done it. Not that you're going to, but you have already. Now I just pray that it would manifest in the hearts and in the lives of your dear children that stand in faith before you this morning. Only you know the hurt. Only you know the pain. Only you know the disappointment. Only you know the grief and the sorrow, Lord. For some here this morning, Lord, it's going to be their first Christmas without a loved one. For some here this morning, Lord, it's the first Christmas that they've heard that maybe themselves or a loved one has been diagnosed with a disease. Emmanuel, God is with us. Touch us. Those of you that are at this altar, just pour your heart out to him right now. Those of you that are still here and can, just stretch your hands and pray for those here this morning. I'm believing God to heal you.
Still a mystery to me. How his infant and eyes have seen the dawn of time. How his ears have heard an angel symphony. But still Mary had to rock her Savior to sleep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Heaven's love reaching down to save the world. Hallelujah. Jesus the Christ, born in Bethlehem, a baby born to save the souls of men. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Heaven's love reaching down to save the world.
Father, I speak your peace now over every heart, over every home. As we leave this room today, we take your peace with us. And I just pray, Lord, right now, as those that have come forward, those that maybe couldn't make it, but we're trusting and believing you to bring healing. Let it manifest in their hearts today. And we'll never cease to give you the praise nor the glory for it. If you believe God's touched some hearts this morning, would you put your hands together right now? Those of you in the altar, stay as long as you want, as long as you need. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you right back here next Sunday morning, 10:30. Bring a friend. Bring some family. God is with us as we continue to unwrap Christmas. God bless you. I love you. I'll see you next Sunday.
You're here.